Hi, I'm Shashank Bhargav, and you're listening to Three Things, the Indian Express news show. On Sunday, the online news platform The Wire reported that a spyware called Pegasus was used to target over 300 mobile phone numbers in India, including that of several journalists, business persons, two serving ministers in the Narendra Modi government, three opposition leaders, and one constitutional authority. The list also included two current and one former Indian Express journalist as well. The Wire was part of a global collaborative investigation project. In this project, a leaked global database of 50,000 telephone numbers was first accessed by the French non-profit Forbidden Stories and Amnesty International, and then shared with 16 media partners that included Guardian and The Washington Post. The spyware Pegasus is one that has been developed by an Israeli firm called NSO, which also made headlines for similar reasons back in 2019. In this episode, we will take a look at just how powerful the spyware Pegasus is, and we will also hear from Indian Express journalist Ritika Chopra, whose number is mentioned in the target list. But first, we take a look at what exactly the report tells us and what we know about the firm NSO. For this, Indian Express's Ashish Aryan joins us. So Ashish, we understand that a software, specifically a spyware, was used to target over 300 mobile phones in India. This spyware called Pegasus was developed by NSO. So could you first talk about NSO and what do we know about this firm?
So what we know so far is that NSO is an Israeli company, which the government has said that it is allegedly run by people who were in the military and now they have retired. So this company has been making software, ever since it has been making software, which it claims that it is only given to vetted foreign governments, which helps these foreign governments or non-Israeli governments track maybe criminals of all sorts of kinds, whether it is drug dealers, whether it is pedophiles, and the rackets across the world which are involved in flesh trade. So that is the claim of the company. And it says that it only deals with governments and it does not deal with any private entities or private companies other than the sovereign governments. So that is the entire setup, or that is the entire idea of the company that we know so far.
So this company is the one that developed the spyware Pegasus that was used to target and snoop on journalists, among other individuals. So what do we know about Pegasus and the things that it can actually do?
So what we know so far is that, like all spywares or all stalkerwares that are there, this is a highly sophisticated spyware. So the initial spyware that Pegasus allegedly released or allegedly used to target journalists. So that was when these people or these victims were sent some links and they clicked on that link and then their devices were infected, which then installed the malware or the spyware on those devices. And then that software, that spyware, it could take instructions from a remote server, and the person sitting on the other side of that remote server, they could turn on your camera or turn your microphone or read your chats, your emails, your SMSs, access your calendar, and so on and so forth. So like I said, since it's a highly sophisticated software, it's very hidden, it's very difficult to track. And mostly how it operates is that it will exploit some very small vulnerability that is there in a regular app that you would use on a day-to-day basis, say WhatsApp or iMessage or even SMS. You wouldn't think twice if something of a link came from a known person, from a best friend or a colleague. So it's very easy to impersonate those people and then infect such devices. So in a nutshell, that is what Pegasus does.
And Pegasus has been in the news for similar reasons in the past as well. Back in 2019, Indian Express had reported that journalists and human rights activists were targeted using Pegasus. What exactly happened back then?
So Shashank, if we look back at the 2019 story also, which the Indian Express broke, was that WhatsApp filed a lawsuit in a US federal court in San Francisco in which it alleged that the Israeli NSO group, it had targeted some 1400 WhatsApp users with Pegasus, and it was done through a very small vulnerability, which WhatsApp said that it had subsequently, when it identified or it had subsequently fixed that, and it had proactively told these users, gone ahead and informed them that there was a vulnerability and there is a company called NSO Pegasus, or there were some actors which tried to access your phone. And since we believe that your phone could be one of the phones which was infected or which was targeted through this attack, therefore, we are informing you so that you can take steps to secure your phone. And similarly, Indian journalists were there, human rights activists were there. Apart from informing them, what it also did is that it sued NSO and Pegasus in the US federal courts, claiming that there was a vulnerability which was exploited by this software, and therefore they were in breach of the softwares of the applications, use it in a manner which at least was not authorized by them.
Okay, so earlier we had a case where at least 1400 WhatsApp users were targeted using Pegasus. And now we understand that 300 mobile phone numbers just in India have been targeted using the spyware. How did we first come to know about this?
So again, like last time it was Citizens Lab, this time it was Amnesty International, and there is another French group called Forbidden Stories, which contacted journalists across the world. And from India, it was the news portal, The Wire, which is run by Mr. Siddharth Varadarajan. So what they found, that they were contacted and they were told that we believe that the NSO Pegasus thing could have continued despite the last exposure. And we believe that there are certain journalists in India, you know, which were targeted. And if you could give us some of the phones. So some of the phones were taken by them. They were tested by independent cybersecurity researchers. And some of them were found to be vulnerable. But the important part is that there are numbers of at least 40 journalists so far that we know who were thought to have been attacked. For example, there's a local journalist from Jharkhand in Ranchi. All the three numbers that he uses were allegedly in that list. So while we should clarify that just because a number is in the list, it does not necessarily mean that it was attacked or it was compromised. But what it tells us is that somebody put that number in that list to maybe snoop on that device. Whether it was successful or not, we really don't know.
So that number could have potentially been targeted or snooped on.
That could have potentially been on the list of people who could have been targeted or who were snooped or who were, you know, followed, or whose phones were at least hacked and all their activities were followed.
And of course, this list also includes the name of a few Indian Express journalists. You have senior assistant editor Ritika Chopra. You have deputy editor Muzammil Jaleel and Sushant Singh, who until recently was with the Indian Express. But do we see a pattern in the list of journalists that have come out?
So what we see, you know, like you rightly pointed out, these journalists, allegedly most of them are critics of the Narendra Modi government. And since they have been targeted, what these journalists are saying, that since they are critics of the Modi government, that is why they were targeted. And, you know, they were working on one or two stories or several stories which would have exposed alleged corruption in the government. And therefore, this spyware and stalkerware was used to see who were they talking to, or what were the contacts that they were accessing, or what were the stories that they were filing, and so on and so forth.
And also, citizens across how many countries have been targeted?
So this is a very expansive project as far as we know. And what we know so far is that it might have been spread across more than 50 countries. And people who worked on this so far, they are saying that more than 50,000 numbers could have been targeted. So the exact umbrella of how many people were targeted would only be clear once all these stories that these organizations such as The Wire are writing, and, you know, globally other organizations are writing. Once all of them come out with all these stories that they have with respect to this, or they come out with a consolidated list, say even country-wise, only then we can, you know, really be sure to the extent of which this app or this spyware was used to maybe spy on activists, journalists, and in some cases, even the family members and friends and relatives of these journalists or politicians and so on and so forth.
Right. In the first story, they have mainly focused on journalists that were targeted. But now, considering that the Israeli firm NSO only deals with vetted governments and sovereign governments, and considering the fact that Indian journalists were on this list, how has the Indian government responded to this development since suspicions are obviously being cast on it?
So the response from India has been that India responded to the mails that these news organizations from across the world sent to the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. And they said that India is a robust democracy that is committed to ensuring the right to privacy to all its citizens as a fundamental right. This is what something that they have reiterated again and again. And they have also said that there has been no unauthorized interception by the government agencies. And if there is requirement for interception, there is a very well-established protocol and a route which includes sanction and supervision by highly ranked officials in the central and state governments. And the reason for interception or snooping on anyone must only be national interest. And these allegations that the government surveils on specific people, the government at least claims that there is no concrete basis on truth or truth associated with this link as far as they are concerned. So that's the line that they are taking, that there is a very well-established procedure through which the government carries out lawful interception for the purpose of maybe national security or if there is any emergency. But in this case, at least, there has been no lawful interception that has been authorized by the government. And this is a stand that the former IT minister, Mr. Ravi Shankar Prasad, had also taken when he said that to the best of his knowledge, there was no lawful interception authorized by any agency of the government of India.
Now, shortly after this recording yesterday, The Wire reported more names of people whose names were either breached or were listed as potential targets by the Pegasus spyware. This included senior Congress leader Rahul Gandhi, election strategist Prashant Kishore, former election commissioner Ashok Lavasa, newly appointed IT minister Ashwini Vaishnaw, minister of state Prahlad Patel, and TMC leader Abhishek Banerjee. The list also included the entire family of a Supreme Court staffer who had accused the then CJI Ranjan Gogoi of sexual harassment in 2019. During the start of the monsoon session yesterday, Ashwini Vaishnaw, whose name features in the list, lashed out at the story and said it was an attempt to malign Indian democracy.
The press reports have appeared a day before the monsoon session of the parliament. This cannot be a coincidence, Honorable Speaker, sir. In the past, similar claims were made regarding the use of Pegasus on WhatsApp. Those reports had no factual basis and were categorically denied by all parties, including in the Supreme Court. The press reports of 18 July 2021 also appear to be an attempt to malign the Indian democracy and its well-established institutions.
The report was also criticized by the former IT minister Ravi Shankar Prasad, who said that there is no evidence linking the report to the government.
Not a shred of evidence has come that in this entire Pegasus story, there is any linkage of the government or the Bharatiya Janata Party. The BJP strongly refutes, condemns the baseless and bereft of political propriety comments leveled by Congress against the BJP.
Now, moving on to the second part of the episode, we focus on Pegasus itself, which is considered the most powerful spyware in the world. In this segment, Nand Gopal Rajan, who writes on technology for the Indian Express, joins us to talk about exactly how Pegasus works. Nandu, you write that Pegasus is the most powerful spyware out there and that it's almost impossible to detect or stop. So could you explain exactly how it works and what makes it impossible to detect?
So Pegasus has been there for quite some time. We have been hearing about it from 2016 onwards, or at least that it's infiltrated devices from 2016 onwards. Generally, it uses what is called a spear phishing attack, or a phishing with PH, not F. So phishing as in, like, you know, your cyber attack kind of phishing. So spear phishing means that you would get a message, a mail or an instant message where you have a link, you click on it, and that triggers something on your phone. So it is basically user initiated in that sense. Or it happens because the user has made a mistake because he did not know he was doing something wrong.
The user would have to click on something or download something in order for it to work.
Exactly. A zero-click attack means that does not need to happen anymore. Let's say you get a mail. It's something, it doesn't even have an attachment at times. So if you have a mail client, like if you use the Apple Mail client, for instance, what it does is that your mails are preloaded for you. Like, you know, it's already downloaded even before the system decides whether it has any vulnerability. And most of the mail clients do have a vulnerability check, but they check basically things like attachments or photographs and stuff. But what it appears here is that regular mail itself could end up having some piece of code in it, which is automatically downloaded by the unsuspecting app, and that triggers the Pegasus installation on your phone. So this means that the user does not know something has happened, which means it's even more difficult to find out that your phone has been hacked. So that is the scary bit. So let us say, you know, if you are a person who thinks that your phone could be attacked, that could be the only reason why you are looking into your phone. But there will be a lot of people who think that you are insignificant and nobody has any reason to look into your phone. But that might be wrong.
And is that what happened in the 2019 Pegasus attack as well, where 1,400 WhatsApp users were targeted? Was that a zero-click attack as well?
I don't think so. I think this is different. This has happened more since 2019 and till 2020. Especially in the iOS, for instance, there was a vulnerability which was sealed around April 2020. But Amnesty is reporting that even phones that had the latest version of the operating system, they had fingerprints of Pegasus as late as last week. So it's still active.
And are all phones vulnerable to such zero-click attacks?
See, every device, a phone, whatever, has something out there which can be tweaked or broken to provide zero-day vulnerability. And that is how this thing works. So, like, you know, everywhere there will be this small gap somewhere. It's just a question of finding it out.
So is this just one of those situations where phone companies are lagging far behind these hackers and agencies that have spotted their vulnerabilities?
Cyber criminals will always be one step ahead, and the tech infrastructure will try and react to something that they do, because you really don't know what vulnerability they will target. And that will be complete out-of-the-box thinking. There are a lot of companies that actively look at what could go wrong. I was today reading about something called fuzzing, you know, in an app. Basically, you have an app and then you try and loosen every single screw technically to see where things could go wrong. And you keep on doing it thousands of times, you know, on a different screw. So you have to do something like that. So you have maybe 1,000 line code. You have to tweak every element of the code to see at which point something goes wrong. And that vulnerability you try and fix. It's not at all easy. But that is the kind of world we could end up in, right? Because, you know, literally have to think out of your shoes to figure out, you know, what is going to happen next, or you completely change the paradigm by bringing in something new.
And what do you think people can do to protect themselves from such attacks?
See, one thing is, despite everything, if you have the latest version of the operating system, if you have the latest version of all the apps that you are running, if you have some kind of a cybersecurity cover on your device, your risk is mitigated to a certain extent. So that is one thing you should do. A lot of people would be on three-year-old versions of their operating system. They can update karega kind of thing. So that doesn't make sense anymore. Because if you're updated, the latest patches will be there, like, you know, and you will get some kind of protection. It's almost like the COVID vaccine, right? Like, no, you think that it's going to help you at least bring down the impact. So that is one. The other thing people have to be careful about is that don't sideload apps. You can't really do it on iOS, but on Android, a lot of people just take apps, like they get WhatsApp or Telegram and load it onto their phone. You never know what is inside those apps. So always download your apps from authentic sources like the App Store and the Google Play Store, even though we are now getting to know that that is might not be good enough, but still it is better than the other thing. The third thing which I heard from an expert is that with a lot of the apps, stop using the app itself. Start using that on the browser. So don't use the Gmail app, just go to your phone browser and check Gmail. Don't use Facebook app, go to your phone browser and open Facebook. Very inconvenient, but it doesn't come with the vulnerabilities that the app will have.
So So far, we have talked about NSO, Pegasus, the WIRES report, and the government's response. But in the end, we speak to Ritika Chopra, who reports on the Education Ministry and the Election Commission for the paper, and whose name is featured on the list of potential targets by the Pegasus spyware. Ritika, you were actually first contacted 2 weeks back by Forbidden Stories, the Paris-based organization that first accessed the leaked data. Could you talk about what that conversation was like, and when did you first come to know that your name was on this list?
So a journalist working with them reached out to me and explained that they were working on an investigative story for which they are reaching out to journalists and requesting them to share a backup of their phone data. And they wanted to check if journalists in India are subjected to surveillance. I mean, obviously, at that point, I wasn't told that this is some sort of a collaborative project and that I wasn't given any reason to believe that I'm actually under surveillance. It seemed more like a project where they were approaching journalists and asking them, rather requesting them for a copy of the data to see if they've ever been under surveillance or whether their phones have ever been infected with malware. I did not want to participate because I frankly didn't know much about this, and I wasn't too comfortable sharing a copy of my mobile phone data with a third party at that point. And so I politely declined that request. But it was on Saturday night, 2 days ago, when I received an email from The Wire, in which a journalist with The Wire informed that my number is on a list of potential targets for surveillance and that they have reasons to believe that my phone may have been attacked with malware in 2019. And they wanted my comment for the same. So that's when I discovered that my number was actually on a list of potential targets for surveillance with this Pegasus spyware.
And what are the reasons you assess that might be the case? The reason why your name is on the list?
So I don't really know whether any attack was really successful on my phone, although my number is on this list. The only way to confirm that would be if I actually permit a third party to do a forensic check on my phone. So I don't want to get into who was behind this or why this happened. I mean, the only thing that I could think of, if at all, my phone was hacked in 2019. One of the biggest stories I did in that year was during the Lok Sabha elections. I was covering the Election Commission, and I had done a story on the difference of opinion between the three election commissioners on a bunch of complaints that had been filed by the opposition on alleged model code violations by Prime Minister Narendra Modi and the then BJP President Amit Shah. So I'd broken a series of stories, about 6-7 of them. But I don't know if it's because of that. Yeah, so I don't really want to speculate on who's behind it or why this, if at all, if it happened, why it happened.
And just knowing that your number is on this list and the fact that such a powerful spyware can be used to get access to your phone, how does it affect the way you report or even just your day-to-day life?
So I think a lot of journalists will agree with me on this. I don't know. I mean, at least I always been operating in a way where I work on this presumption that I am being watched, irrespective of whether I am or not. Maybe I just feel I'm too important in my head. But I think that's sort of a safe approach. So when you have this thought at the back of your head that you are possibly being watched, I mean, you work accordingly. So, I mean, how this affects my work, I mean, if you honestly ask me, aside from the surprise, I really don't think this would really affect my work, given that this is what we do for a living. We know how to protect our sources. We have our ways of doing that. I mean, I don't want to get into how I do this, but I think all journalists have their ways of protecting sources. I mean, that's at the core of our reporting. So I really don't think this will affect my reporting. And I don't think people will stop reaching out to me because of this incident, purely because, I mean, getting in touch with someone through their phone is not the only way. I mean, there are several other ways of reaching out to a journalist.
And the fact that journalists from so many countries are on this list, and we saw this back in 2019 as well, what kind of concerns does it raise for journalism in general?
So while we don't know who is behind this attempt at surveillance in the current case, but it's not something new. The people have been put under surveillance through illegal, unauthorized means. Journalists have broken these stories even in the past. To me personally, if it's my work that has resulted in this, that me being put under surveillance. And if just asking the right questions or breaking stories or informing public debate with new facts, if that is what led to all of this, I guess as a journalist, then it just motivates me more to continue doing what I'm doing. That is my approach personally to this, that I can't let this come in the way of my journalism. In fact, I have to, this in a way would motivate me to do what I'm doing.
You are listening to Three Things by The Indian Express. Today's show was written and produced by me, Shashank Bhargav, and was edited and mixed by Suresh Pawar. If you like the show, then do subscribe to us wherever you get your podcasts. You can also recommend the show to someone you think will like it, share it with a friend or someone in your family. It's the best way for people to get to know about us. You can tweet us at Express Podcasts and write to us at podcasts@indianexpress.com.